it's one of those moments in history where history is slowly changing with this pandemic that is upon us. We have missed, or we were not there when the world wars were fought. We were not there when independence was achieved. Many of us were not there when the emergency was there. But this, when the life of India is written, India's response as a nation to the pandemic will often be determined by how exactly its citizens behaved. How did they behave with the state? How did they behave with one another? Because if you look at citizenship, citizenship is essentially a constitutional compact, a constitutional covenant between citizen and citizen and the state that they all together create. What is the state to do? What how do its various organs function inter se? And what kind of state have the citizens agreed to build? All these presuppose a basic question. What exactly is a citizen? Who is a citizen? How did a citizen come into being and to definition? And here, it just reminds me that it was 70 years ago that the people of India made a tryst with our constitution. Now the time has come when we are called upon to redeem our pledge, maybe not wholly or in full measure, but possibly very substantially. I cannot but help recall today the bleak prognostications we were offered as we in 1950s set upon our journey of citizenship. Winston Churchill on 20th September 1947 had warned, "How can you suppose that the 1,000-year gulf which yawns between Muslim and Hindu will be bridged in 14 months? The Indian parties and political classes do not represent the Indian masses. No arrangement can be made about all the great common services. All will be the preparation for the ensuing civil war. In handing over the government of India to the so-called political classes, you're handing over to men of straw, of whom in a few years no trace will remain." Churchill may well have had reasons for his pessimism. We Indians, after all, had no experience of being citizens. We had all along been subjects of various rajas, nawabs, or the British King Emperor. We were now being called upon to be citizens of an independent republic. Having fought for freedom from British rule and having secured it, we had begun the task of independently governing ourselves under a constitution. We entrusted the task to a constituent assembly whose debates continue to illuminate and enlighten us even today. The Constituent Assembly labored hard from the 9th of December 1946 to the 26th of November 1949 to produce a very long document that did not meet with immediate universal acclaim. Kengal Hanumanthaiya later expressed lack of indigeneity in the Indian Constitution, said, "We wanted the music of a veena or a sitar, but here we have the music of an English band." Nevertheless, a mammoth task had been accomplished. As Dr. Ambedkar narrated, the draft constitution as prepared by the constitutional advisor as a text for the drafting committee to work upon consisted of 243 articles and 13 schedules. The first draft constitution as presented by the drafting committee to the Constituent Assembly contained 315 articles and 8 schedules. At the end of the consideration stage, the number of articles in the draft constitution increased to 386. In the final form, the draft constitution contains 395 articles and 8 schedules. The total number of amendments to the draft constitution tabled were approximately 7,635. Of them, the total number of amendments actually moved in the House was 2,473. The president of the Constituent Assembly, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, prophesied at its birth, "Whatever the constitution may or may not provide, the welfare of the country will depend upon the way in which the country is administered. That will depend upon the men who administer it." It's a trite saying that a country can only have the government it deserves. Our constitution has provisions in it which appear to be some to be objectionable from one point of view or another. we must admit that the defects are inherent in the situation in the country and the people at large. If the people who are elected are capable men and men of character and integrity, they would be able to make the best of even a defective constitution. If they are lacking in this, the constitution cannot help the country. After all, a constitution is like a machine is a lifeless thing. It acquires life because of the men who control it and operate it. 70 years after these words of warning, we are now engaged in a great constitutional conversation about citizenship, which was fought out on the streets through ballot boxes and in the courts. The conversation has currently been paused by the pandemic, which, as I said, is testing our commitments of citizenship to one another and to the state. The conversation has come about with varying ideas of citizenship, all contending in the marketplace of ideas. There are those who think they have a first right on citizenship of this country, a right which may extend to even defining the rights of those who are not exactly like them. There are others who dare to assert at long last that they will not be treated unequally in the matter of citizenship. There are those who still can't fathom what all the fuss is about. Citizenship is simply the right to have rights. Only a citizen can assert some rights against all, including the state. The loss of citizenship or a state of statelessness often renders the individual remediless against state or private action. In Western thought, the roots of citizenship go back to the city-states of ancient Greece. Aristotle's Politics talks about the nature of citizenship in Athens. A translation of what he wrote reads, "It must be admitted that we cannot consider all those to be citizens who are necessary to the existence of the state. For example, children are not citizens equally with grown-up men who are citizens absolutely. But children, not being grown up, are only citizens on a certain assumption. In ancient times and amongst some nations, the class were slaves or foreigners, and therefore the majority of them are so now. The best form of state will not admit them to citizenship, but if they are admitted, then our definition of the virtue of a citizen will not apply to every citizen or to every free man as such, but only to those who are freed from necessary services. The necessary people are either slaves who minister to the wants of individuals or mechanics and laborers who are the servants of the community." Thus, ancient Greece had different kinds of inhabitants and different kinds of citizens, and only a full citizen would be able to participate in the day-to-day happenings of the state as a male, a patriarch, and a warrior. The Roman Republic, after the collapse of the old monarchy, had a few families ruling them, and they were called the patricians. The rest of the citizens were called plebeians. The first Roman law code, the 12 tables, had separate laws for these two classes. With the tag of citizenship came some rights, but that too was restricted to certain citizens and not all. Women were always outcast from participating in the Roman Republic. Thus, ancient Rome and Greece had citizenships not dissimilar to the Indian citizen about which Dr. Ambedkar had warned. On the 26th of January 1950, we are going to enter into a life of contradictions. In politics, we will have equality, and in social and economic life, we will have inequality. In politics, we will be recognizing the principle of one man, one vote, and one vote, one value. In our social and economic life, we shall try, by reason of our social and economic structure, continue to deny the principle of one man, one value. How long shall we continue to live this life of contradictions? How long shall we continue to deny equality in our social and economic life? If we continue to deny it for long, we will do so only by putting our political democracy in peril. We must remove these contradictions at the earliest possible moment, or else those who suffer from inequality will blow up the structure of political democracy which this assembly has so laboriously built up. Those words of warning nearly 70 years ago. seem to be so prophetic today when there is such a struggle on what is citizenship. Let me now take you through to how the Constituent Assembly debated questions on citizenship on 3 days, that is the 10th of August, 11th of August and 12th of August 1949. The idea behind adding citizenship was not in any general sense, but citizenship on the date of commencement of the Constitution. It was not the object of the Assembly to lay down a permanent definition of citizenship. Future parliaments were to have full power to make laws on the question. Echoes of the communally charged atmosphere of partition resounded in the Assembly as it debated what eventually got enacted as Article 7. Though marks of difference were not openly displayed, they are easily recognizable in the debates on Article 6 and 7 of the Constitution. Article 6 was obviously unexceptionable as it guaranteed rights of citizenship for what were largely Hindu migrants from Pakistan, commonly described in the discourse of that time as refugees. You see, the Constituent Assembly was meeting in the backdrop of partition. It had been constituted before partition, and for the first nearly 6 or 8 months of its life, it just waited to find out how things were going to go about, what happened after the Radcliffe line was drawn. And there were people who went backward and forward over those lines. Man-made lines take time to solidify into borders. And there were many who even then believed that all this was sort of temporary, that partition was temporary, that maybe the Muslims had gone away into Pakistan, but maybe that the partition could be undone, and that at a later stage when the politics of the time had come down, maybe we would there could be a confederation again. But the various views that were debated in the Assembly, I'm just going to give you a flavor of what a lot of people said. There's one Mr. Punjab Rao Deshmukh from Vidarbha. He was a barrister and an untouchability fighter. He thought that the provisions in the draft articles made Indian citizenship the cheapest citizenship on earth. He thought Indian citizenship was being given to easily. His grouse was with citizenship by birth. According to him, if the draft article were to be accepted, even the child born of a lady while she was transiting through the Bombay port would get citizenship. He asked for at least 2 amendments. Firstly, just being born in India shouldn't be sufficient. The child should be born to Indian parents. Next, all Hindus and Sikhs residing anywhere in the world should be entitled to Indian citizenship. Let me quote what he said. He said, "I do not cite any ground whatsoever that we should do it unless it is the specious, oft-repeated, nauseating principle of secularity of the state. I think we are going too far in this business of secularity. Does it mean we must wipe out our own people, that we must wipe them out in order to prove our secularity, that we must wipe out everything that is sacred and dear to Indians to prove that we are secular?" Mr. Deshmukh emphasized on the fact that Pakistan was formed on the basis of religion and all Muslims have an exclusive place for themselves. So accordingly, he suggested that only Hindus and Sikhs should be entitled to return as citizens of India. There was then Pandit Thakur Das Bhargava, who was also a lawyer from Punjab. He had a slightly different take. He said, "If a Muslim comes to India and bears allegiance to India and loves India as we love her, I have nothing but love for that man. But even after partition, for reasons best known to themselves, many Muslims have come to Assam with a view to make a Muslim majority in that province for election purposes and not to live in Assam as citizens of India. My humble submission is that those persons who have come here for a purpose which is certainly not very justifiable, those who have come here on the account of disturbances in Pakistan or fear of disturbance, then they must certainly get asylum in India. If any nationalist Musliman who is afraid of the Muslims of East Pakistan or West Pakistan comes to India, he certainly should be welcome. It is our duty to see he is protected. We will treat him as our brother and a bona fide national of India. In regard to those others who have not come here on account of disturbances, we should not allow them to become citizens of India if we can help it." Then there was a Parsi from Karachi, one Mr. Rustam Sidwa, who represented the central provinces. He felt that there were communities other than Hindus and Sikhs that needed to be addressed, such as Parsis. He insisted that the articles on citizenship should not have any mention of any community per se. Mr. Mehboob Ali Beg Saab Bahadur from Hyderabad said, the interpretation put upon the provision by Dr. Deshmukh is not at all correct. In support of his observations, he quoted the instances of the United States of America, Australia, South Africa. He said, look at those countries. They do not give citizenship rights to Indians, even when they have been in those countries for 30 or 35 years. May I put him the question whether we should follow their examples? Can we, with any reason or pretense, tell these persons, look here, you have not given citizenship right to Indians living in your countries for decades. Can we complain against them if we are going to deny them citizenship rights here? Let us not follow those bad examples, whether it is possible or not. Shall we now follow those retrograde countries like Australia in the manner of conferring citizenship rights and say that citizenship will not be available except on very strict conditions? It is very strange that Dr. Deshmukh should contemplate giving citizenship rights only to persons who are Hindus or Sikhs by religion. He characterized the provision in the article guaranteeing citizenship right as ridiculously cheap. I would say, on the other hand, that his conception is ridiculous. Therefore, let us not follow the example of those countries which we are condemning everywhere, not only here, but also in the United Nations, and complaining that although Indians have been living in those countries, they have not been granted citizenship rights there. Pandit Nehru opposed religion-based citizenship, saying, one has to inevitably to do something which involves the greatest amount of justice to our people and which is the most practical solution of the problem. You cannot, in any such provision, lay down more or less whom you like and whom you dislike. You have to lay down certain principles. But any principles that you may lay down is likely not to fit in with the number of cases. It cannot be helped in any event. Therefore, you see that the principle fits with a vast majority of cases. Mr. Aladi Krishnaswamy Iyer of the drafting committee said, we applied it to the principles of a secular state. We may make a distinction between people who have voluntarily and deliberately chosen another country as their home and those who want to retain their connection with this country. But we cannot, on any racial or religious or other grounds, make a distinction between one kind of person and another, or one sect of persons and another sect of persons, having regard to our commitments. Returning to what Mr. Brijeshwar Prasad said, he also said, I wish all the people of Pakistan should be invited to come and stay in this country if they so like. And why do I say so? I am not an idealist. I say this because we are wedded to this principle, to this doctrine, to this ideal. Long before Mahatma Gandhi came into politics, before recorded history, Hindus and Muslims in this country were one. We were talking during the time of Mahatma Gandhi that we are blood brothers. May I know if after partition these blood brothers have become strangers and aliens? I think the mischief it all is of the first step. I want that the establishment of common citizenship between India and Pakistan is of vital importance for peace and progress of Asia as a whole. Some had also suggested that further debate was required. The members finally came to a consensus that future parliaments would have the ultimate power to legislate on these questions. Any defects that experience disclosed could thus be rectified at a later date. The constitutional provisions were only meant to determine citizenship at the time of the commencement of the constitution. The transitional citizenship clauses were the most complex for the draftsmen to pen down. They had been sent back on two previous occasions. Therefore, at the commencement of the constitution, persons who had been born in India, or either of whose parents were born in India, or who had ordinarily been resident for the 5 preceding years, or those who had come over from Pakistan, were granted Indian citizenship. Article 11 enabled future parliaments to make provisions with respect to the acquisition and terms of other matters relating to citizenship. The power given to Parliament was then substantively exercised by putting in a framework for citizenship under the Citizenship Act of 1955, which was enacted by the first Parliament. Under the Citizenship Act, citizenship can be granted, acquired by birth, by descent, by registration, or by naturalization. Subsequently, rules regarding citizenship were formulated. Currently, the citizenship rules of 2009 supplement the Act of 1955. Another act which impacts the discussion on citizenship is the Foreigners Act of 1946. This is a pre-constitutional act. The Foreigners Act provides for measures including detection of foreigners, and the rules provide for tribunals to determine questions of nationality. Cast the onus of proving that such person is not a foreigner or is not such a foreigner of such particular class or description upon such person. Decoded, it only means that if you are accused of being a foreigner, the onus is upon you to prove that you are not, in fact, a foreigner. This act has had a devastating effect upon the poor without documents, especially in the case of Assam's citizenship crisis, to which I shall now advert. And because the story in Assam and its fights over who are citizens and who are not citizens has had a great impact on the current dialogue on citizenship in the rest of the country. Assam and the Northeast have had a convoluted history and geography which have impacted India, its neighbors, and their inhabitants. The Ahoms are but one of the ethnicities that have made the Brahmaputra Valley their home. The first Ahom ruler, Sutapa, is said to have come from Yunnan in China in the beginning of the 13th century. The areas around modern state of Assam were ceded to the British by the Burmese under the Treaty of Yanbo in 1826. These fertile but sparsely populated areas were over the years occupied by tea gardens and farms which attracted peasants, and after the partition of Bengal for a brief period between 1905 to 1911, ruled from Dhaka. In 1912, it again became a separate province. At the time of independence, it had a very mixed population. Some of the other districts with substantial Muslim populations made by the late Lokbandhu Gopinath Bordoloi. However, with all this mixed history and mixed population, questions of citizenship of the newly independent countries of India and Pakistan had to be determined with people still crossing and returning over porous borders. At this stage, in the early 50s, by a secret administrative exercise, a National Register of Citizens for Assam was drawn up in 1951. The register was not complete in some districts, nor was it drawn up as a fully determinative exercise. After the war ended, under the Indira Mujib Pact, Bangladesh agreed to take back those who had migrated after March 25, 1971, while India agreed to retain those who had entered prior to that date. While Tripura and West Bengal endured the refugee influx, the native Ahoms in Assam viewed it as an accretion to the traditional Congress vote bank of Ali, Kuli, and Bengali. In the 1978 by-election to the Lok Sabha from a place called Mangaldoi, an unprecedented increase in the number of Muslim names in the voters' list sparked off protests from the All Assam Students Union. Resultantly, the Assam agitation against foreigners was sparked off. The agitation had its apogee in the Nelli massacre on 18th February 1983. When over 2,000 men, women, and infants were killed. The massacre led to large-scale detention of the movement's leaders, which only ended with the Assam Accord of 1985. Under the accord, post-1971 migrants were to be deported after determination by special tribunals. This accord allowed relative peace to return to Assam and paved the way for Assamese student leaders Prafulla Mahanta and Bhrigu Phukan to come into power as chief minister and cabinet minister respectively. As long as the Ahom Gana Parishad remained in power, expulsion of aliens remained only a desirable consummation devoutly to be wished for. As the Congress came back into power and regained it for three terms, the ethnic cauldron began to simmer. The then leader from the All Assam Students Union, Sarbananda Sonowal, got the Illegal Migrants Determination Tribunal struck down by the Supreme Court in the year 2005. The ground that found favor with the Supreme Court was that casting the burden upon the accuser to prove that the respondent was a foreigner was unworkable and arbitrary. The effect of striking down the Illegal Migrants Determination Act was that questions of determination of nationality went from the IMDT tribunal to the Foreigners Tribunal under the Foreigners Act, where the burden was not on the accuser, but on the person accused of not being an Indian. The resultant effect has been huge human misery among the poor and the undocumented. An enumerator of the Election Commission, normally a lower level government servant, who came across a non-Assamese speaking family headed by a Mr. X who was wearing suspect clothing, marked the voter as doubtful and may have made a reference to the IMDT tribunal, which may have sent a notice. That notice may or may not have been served. The matter would have been referred to the Foreigners Tribunal after the IMDTs were wound up. Many years later, these Foreigners Tribunals would proceed to ex parte rule that Mr. X had not proved his citizenship and hence was a foreigner liable to be deported. And in the meanwhile, he was to be detained till such deportation was carried out. The orders of the tribunals could be challenged in the writ courts, but the Guwahati High Court and often the Supreme Court had an unblemished record of not interfering by citing the limitations of writ jurisdiction, which would not get into questions of fact. Into this toxic mess of bad ideas, another bad idea also took root. It was argued by some that if only the 1951 NRC was updated to take into account those who could trace their ancestry to people who had been enumerated on that list, the new list would reveal undoubted citizens, because those who failed to prove ancestry would be either illegal migrants from Bangladesh or internal migrants from the rest of India. The Congress government of Tarun Gogoi had started a pilot project in a few districts, but had to abandon it in the face of local resistance. In 2013, a Supreme Court bench headed by Justice Ranjan Gogoi directed the state of Assam to update the 1951 NRC by the 1st of January 2016. The judgment, which is reported as Assam Sanmalita Mahasangh, verges on xenophobia when it asks the Constitution bench to determine if an influx of illegal migrants into a state of India constitutes external aggression and or internal disturbance. Does the expression state occurring in this article refer only to the territorial region, or does it also include the people living in the state, which would include their culture and identity? Thus, it has brought into law the concept that people having only a particular culture or ethnic identity were the undoubted citizens of a geographical area which constituted India, and that these people who claim to be original inhabitants could exclude the others as foreigners. The Supreme Court then went on a continued exercise of micromanaging the task of updating the 1951 NRC of Assam, and it did allow extensions for completion of the exercise. When the final updated NRC was released on August 31st, 2019, around 19 lakh applicants did not find their names in it. The majority of exclusions, nearly 11 lakh names, were not Muslim names. These figures must be looked at in the context of what the Supreme Court itself had relied upon in its judgment in 2013. It records, on 14th July 2004, in response to an unstarred question pertaining to deportations of illegal Bangladeshi migrants, the Minister of State Home Affairs submitted a statement in Parliament indicating that the estimated number of illegal Bangladeshi immigrants into Assam, into India on 31st December 2001 was 1.20 crores, of which 50 lakhs were in Assam. So if in 2004, there were 50 lakh illegal migrants in Assam, one would normally have expected the number to go up. Today, with the updation, you have a situation where 19 lakhs do not appear to have consolidated their claim. And of those 19 lakhs, it is not as if the majority are Muslim either. So thus, the NRC updating exercise has become like Virgil. It lists none to praise and very few to love. The question is, what is to be done with those who do not figure in that list? Mass deportation is not possible. No country will be willing to reclaim nearly 2 million people, most of whom were not born anywhere else but India. Does the state of Assam detain them, or does the center provide a path to citizenship for all or only some of them? It is in this context that the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2019 and the opposition thereto must be seen. At this stage, I must also take you through the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2003 during the earlier NDA regime, which we must look at. It was passed with the support of several opposition parties. The bill was discussed more as a dual citizenship bill for the introduction of the idea of overseas citizen of India. But the CAA 2003 introduced a new term called illegal migrant, a foreigner who had entered into India without a valid passport or visa or had overstayed the visa. So now a foreigner had two subsets, the illegal migrants and other foreigners. CAA 2003 also introduced one more change. It said those classified as illegal migrants would never become citizens of India. And what's more, the children born from a union of a citizen and an illegal migrant could never get citizenship. The CAA 2003 also introduced another nationwide register of citizens. At this juncture in time, it is very difficult to say why these amendments were necessitated when citizenship by registration or naturalization were not by right, but were discretionary. The government always had the discretion to allow or not any application for citizenship by registration or naturalization. You've had the cases of Pakistani citizens like Adnan Sami, who have been granted Indian citizenship, despite the fact that their fathers were even in the Pakistani armed forces. So there was always the discretion with the government to grant or not grant naturalization. However, with the blanket demonization of foreigners without papers in 2003, India has effectively made it impossible for any foreigner living without papers in India for whatever reason, fleeing persecution, economic opportunities, or otherwise, to apply for citizenship. A further crisis has been created by which children born out of the union of an Indian citizen and a foreigner without papers could also not apply for citizenship. After the BJP came into power again in 2014, they set out to correct their mistake made in CAA 2003. In 2016, a bill reflecting the discrimination was introduced in Parliament, seeking exemptions for Hindus, Buddhists, Jains, Sikhs, Christians, and Parsis from Pakistan, Bangladesh, and Afghanistan from being classified as illegal migrants. Thus, an attempt was made to apply the concept of illegal migrants of CAA 2003 only to Muslim foreigners. The 2016 bill, however, lapsed with Parliament's term. The BJP manifesto for the 2019 election contained the following paras under the heading Nation First. The BJP said, "We are committed to the enactment of the Citizenship Amendment Bill for protection of individuals of religious minority communities from neighboring countries escaping persecution. We will make all efforts to clarify the issues to the sections of population from the northeastern states who have expressed apprehensions regarding the legislation. We reiterate our commitment to protect the linguistic and cultural and social identity of the Northeast. Hindus, Jains, Buddhists, and Sikhs escaping persecution from the neighboring countries will be given citizenship in India. There has been a huge change in the cultural and linguistic identity. Of some areas due to illegal immigration, resulting in an adverse impact on local people's livelihood and employment. We will expeditiously complete the NRC process in these areas on priority. In future, we will implement the NRC in a phased manner in other parts in the country. Thus, the BJP manifesto promised citizenship only to Hindus, Sikhs, and Buddhists escaping persecution. The manifesto did not promise citizenship to similarly placed Christians and Parsis. Also, the manifesto did not cherry-pick specific countries from the neighborhood to identify with persecution. A question is how other countries in the neighborhood, especially Sri Lanka and Burma, got excluded in the notifications and in CAA 2019. It may well be that under political compulsions or legal advice that Christians and Parsis were then included in the notifications and in CAA 2019. So now I have taken you through the entire conspectus of circumstances which underlay the Citizenship Act and the protests against it. The Act deliberately seeks to classify claims of citizenship based upon the religion of the applicant. Hovering in the background is the electoral promise to have a national registration of citizens and population. Implicit in this promise is the possibility of discriminating between citizens and the general population. That today, as a republic, we are again questioning constitutional choices made by our founding fathers on secularism and on citizenship. Citizenship in the United States has often been described in two culinary metaphors, the melting pot and the salad bowl. Into the melting pot go a whole host of ingredients to melt into a compound American whose ancestry can be one part Cherokee, one part African, two parts Chinese, four parts Ukrainian, or some such other composition. In a salad bowl, however, ingredients do not mix, do mix, but do not fuse. Hence, we have Indian Americans, Chinese Americans, Latino Americans, and whatnot. Whether salad bowl or melting pot, there is no doubt, however, that the vessel is all American. As Thomas Paine put it, our citizenship in the United States is our national character. Our citizenship in any particular state is our only our local distinction. By the latter, we are known at home, by the former to the world. Our great title is Americans, our inferior one varies with the place. Now, if I were to extend culinary metaphors to Indian citizenship, my dish of choice would be the bhel puri. That marvelous mixture best had on a Bombay beach has puffed rice, savory crisp noodles called sev, fried crisp puris, chopped onions, coriander and spices, all tossed together with a dressing of tamarind, milk and cilantro chutney. Each ingredient is separate and distinct, can be singled out, picked up and separately consumed. However, when all these ingredients are mixed in the right proportions and tossed in an overall common vinaigrette, the resultant mixture is an explosion of delight on the tongue and heart. The bhel puri that is India has Maharashtrians, Gujaratis, Bengalis, Punjabis, and many more who are also Hindus, Muslims, Sikhs, Christians, Buddhists, atheists, agnostics. And Indians' multiple markers of identity often leave both majoritarian and minoritarian elements in the same individual. As a Kannadiga Hindu living in Delhi, I'm part of a religious majority and a linguistic minority. Yet I am as wholly and fiercely Indian as the most orthodox Pandit from Varanasi or a Maulvi from Deoband or a Christian priest from Goa. We have seen a stable nation emerge. India may be a nation, but as a modern republic, it is barely 70 years old. For 70 years, this republic has trundled along on implicit assumption of citizenship. If the operation of a temporary or permanent brute majority in parliament enables the division of the general population into citizens and other inhabitants on sufferance, a house divided against itself will not long endure. It is for us who cherish the constitutional promise of liberty, equality, and fraternity to step up and defend those fraternal bonds that have kept us together. I hope that we as Indians continue a long journey of citizenship together. Thank you very much for a very patient listening and for holding on through the technical problems.
So we have a few questions with us, which if you would permit me, I would like to take up. So the first question is, what will happen to people, non-migrants, but Muslims, who cannot claim citizenship as per the CAA, even though they are Indian citizens by birth, but due to the illiteracy and lack of access to government schemes and facilities, they fail to enroll themselves into required procedures such as birth certificates, etc. What are the remedies available to them under the Act?
See, right now there are no questions on citizenship. People are presumed to be Indian citizens. The government has continually taken the defense that the Citizenship Amendment Act is not designed to exclude people from citizenship. It is designed only to include a few people who have come from outside. The real fear, however, is based on the Assam experience, where in Assam, everybody who could not prove positively that he was an Indian citizen has been treated as a foreigner. The first thing is that what has happened in Assam has shown you how unworkable that proposition is. What do you do if you, by your domestic law, declare somebody not to be a citizen? Do you lock him up indefinitely and throw away the key? That is what the Assamese tried to do. And as a consequence, you sent people into detention camps, deportation camps. Say, but where did you deport them? You could not deport them because Bangladesh just refused to receive them.
The exercise of detecting foreigners and trying to deport them, which happened in Assam, must be seen as being peculiar to the facts of that state. It is unlikely to be repeated now anywhere else in the country. It, I think, has become reasonably clear to the administration that any large-scale exercise of depriving people of citizenship will be fraught with consequences both here as well as elsewhere. So what may be a good soundbite for their electorate may not necessarily be a good policy. I doubt that what has taken place in Assam hitherto will be replicated. Even in Assam, I see things of in terms of a winding down of the excesses which took place earlier. The Supreme Court has now released many of the people who are put in detention, saying that if you've served 2 years, now that's it. Let's go. We will determine citizenship and other issues later. I think that the fight over citizenship has been a good fight. It has by no means been won, or it has by no means been officially conceded. But nevertheless, the limits of what a country can or cannot do have become clear to any wise administration.
We will move on to the next question, sir. The querist wants to know that, in your view, what would be the best suggestion or change that can take place that you would recommend could be made to the latest amendment to the CAA?
Now, the one simple way is to make it non-discriminatory. After all, the ultimate act of granting citizenship is entirely in the hands of the government of the day. So when you say you can say that anybody fleeing persecution, irrespective of religion, why do you have to name 7 or 8 religions to pointedly exclude one religion? You offer citizenship to anybody pursuing fleeing persecution, and then when it comes to the actual working of the of citizenship, then it is entirely a matter of administrative discretion. But as legislative policy, please make it non-denominational.
So we will move on to the next question. Even if it were to be conceded for the sake of argument that CAA 2019 makes a reasonable classification of persecuted persons belonging to certain faiths, will it not impinge on our constitutional promise of religious freedom for all persons in India?
essentially, while you make classifications, but merely putting out labels is not classification. If the classification is persecuted people for whom you are offering citizenship, then you cannot say only these within that class of persecuted people, only these people pursuing a particular set of religions I will give citizenship to, and not give it to people following another religion or having another religious heritage. This would not be reasonable classification. This would be also opposed to secularism, which is part of the basic structure of the constitution. If and when the Supreme Court finally hears the matter, I expect that all these questions will have to be reasonably well gone into.
So the next question is, CAA 2019 in its statements and objects speaks about illegal migrants and not refugees who have fled from Pakistan, Afghanistan and Bangladesh. Is this to sidestep the UN Convention on the Status of Refugees, followed by the Protocol of 1967, of which India is not a signatory?
See, the point with refugees is that refugees are temporary. Refugees normally tend to go back to the country of origin whenever the troubles die down in that country. Of course, there have been cases where the mother country, the troubles never die down, and the refugees then, as time goes by and as they have children in the new country, then tend to adopt citizenship of the new country. But as long as they are refugees, there is normally no question of citizenship. There are only questions of residence. So I don't think there was any particular policy to get out of any UN conventions. The phrase illegal migrants comes because of the 2003 amendment, which brought in the concept of illegal migrants. So it was a continuation of that idea.
Thank you, sir. So this is the last question of the day. So the querist wants to know that how would you respond to legal experts who state that constitutional provisions that grant power to the Indian Parliament to determine citizenship are to be found in Part 2 of the Constitution and shouldn't be confused with fundamental rights, including Article 14, which are laid down in Part 3 of the Constitution?
Well, let's put it this way. Part 3 of the Constitution are fundamental to citizens, and certain rights out there are available to everybody. Part 3 often has such rights which are so fundamental to who we are as human beings that even if Part 3 did not exist, they would still be required by any civilized government to be recognized and enforced. Now, Part 2, as I have told you, a chapter relating to citizenship, was largely an exercise by the Constituent Assembly to determine who would be citizens at the commencement of the Constitution. While they laid down that Parliament could make laws for the future, they of course meant that whatever Parliament did would still be subject to the other provisions of the Constitution, including the fundamental rights chapter, which is Part 3. I don't think that you can advance a proposition of law saying that the founding fathers of the Republic did not intend Parliament to be bound by the fundamental rights chapter when it came to determining citizenship. Citizenship, ultimately, in my view, would have to follow that great verse from Rahat Indori, which says that hai sabhi ka khoon yahan ki mitti mein shamil, kisi ke baap ka Hindustan thodi hai.
Thank you.
Your citizenship is in India should not necessarily be dependent on who your ancestors are. If you were born in India and if you have lived in India and if you have forever been willing to subject yourself to all of India's law, you should be an Indian citizen.